Amazing, amazing the way that life turns around here. Joining me in studio is the former president and CEO of the National NAACP. We just had somebody that followed his footsteps on board in Ben Jealous in the last hour, former Maryland congressman from the 7th Congressional District, following my uncle, Congressman Perrin J. Mitchell, and a former talk show host on Two-Way Talk, Morgan. He was only 21 at the time, ladies and gentlemen, back in 1979 on Two-Way Talk on WEAA. Kweisi Mfume joins me here in studio. Kweisi, good morning. How are you?
Thank you, Clarence. I'm doing great. Good to be here.
I appreciate you coming, and I reached out to you because I really wanted to reach out to some sage, and I use that in the most, not age-wise, but just
that's
in terms
okay.
of
I'm
wisdom.
Still here.
In the wisdom category, sage voices to comment on our issues, not only here in Maryland, but nationally. And you can join us, 410-467-WBAR. You can text us, 410-467-9225. I was beginning this way, Kweisi, as you know, it was just a few years ago, there was a certain television show around here called Bottom Line, which was right downstairs. And I happened to appear a couple of times as a guest with you. Now that I get you to appear on my show, I feel like, you know, I've kind of turned the table a little bit here.
Well, thank you. It was a good show. WBAR ran it. We did it live, by the way, for 9 years.
Wow.
Don't ask me how.
You did.
Once a week.
And with the audience.
Yeah, and half the time I was in Congress, so I had to beat a track up the BW Parkway to get back here before a live audience. But those were good old days of TV when there was an emphasis on local shows.
And an emphasis on local issues. And we can begin with this governor's race. I just spoke with Ben Jealous, Kweisi, and you have not endorsed anybody in this governor's race because you are the chair of the Board of Regents for Morgan State University, and you do have, you know, that level of, you have to back away from that. But when you look at this governor's race, particularly Democratic governor's race, we had 9 candidates down to 8 now with Valerie Ervin leaving. It has descended now into a lot of name-calling. You're a carpetbagger. You discriminated against women. You had a woman fired. I just want to get your take on the way this campaign is going, and then how do you bring, as Democrats, bring this back together after Election Day tomorrow?
Well, the second question is the hardest, so let me start with the first. I think more than anything else, it's important in a field of candidates this large to focus on what they see as the future and not to spend most of their time criticizing what they see as the present, because we all have different opinions about whether or not the economy is good or bad, whether the streets are safe or not safe, whether Maryland is moving or not moving. You've got to talk about what you see and what you want to do and how things will look different under you and how you're going to pay for things and why people then ought to embrace this idea who may not have been inclined to vote for you. You've got to do that, and then when you do that, you start to develop a base. But if you don't do that, it becomes very difficult in a field of 7 or 8 people.
One of the things that you know, Kweisi Mfume, is we all, my family in politics, all of us, we were able to get our vote out. We were able to get the big GOTV, that movement out. There are some estimates that we might have as low as a 25% turnout, even though we had a 56% increase in early voting from 2014. That a lot of people think that was displaced voters from tomorrow, Tuesday, and not necessarily new voters. Just the whole issue of exciting people to vote. And the reason I mention that, Kweisi, is we've seen poll after poll showing such a large undecided in this race of candidates. I'm not sure if people are motivated to go vote.
A lot of the undecideds have to deal with the fact that I think they've got a very popular governor in a state where we're used to having Democratic governors, but a Republican governor that has approval ratings that are extremely high across the board, across race, across most dividers and categories, regardless of whether it's age or it's urban or rural or whatever. So that's the first thing that's in place. The second thing is this field, again, of so many candidates. It makes it hard for people to distinguish, and it confuses, I think, a lot of voters. Not that they don't know who they like, but who is it they don't like?
Right,
I mean,
right.
There's a lot of rhetoric and a lot of commercials now going back and forth with accusations. It's going to be very difficult after this to, I think, find a way to get back to a singular message again. That's going to be the real challenge for the Democratic Party.
When you look at somebody like former Vice President Joe Biden coming into Maryland, I believe it's this weekend, to try to pull Humpty Dumpty kind of back together again, how do you feel that plays like an outsider? I mean, he's still Vice President, but he's kind of an outsider trying to come in to pull this together.
Yeah, Joe, I think, probably more so than anybody else on the Democratic side right now, has the ability to kind of grab the ear and the attention of a disparate group of Democratic voters. Whether or not they still come behind the message is another thing. You know, I remember your dad and I being on the floor of Madison Square Garden in 1980. I was a Kennedy surrogate. Ted had run that year against a popular president, Jimmy Carter.
Some people think had the convention lasted a little longer, he might have taken Jimmy Carter out. That's a whole other discussion, but go ahead. I was there, too, by the way.
Yeah, and, you know, that Thursday night, when those two candidates came out on stage, is usually the night where you heal the party and bring it back together, the same thing that's going to happen here vis-a-vis Joe Biden. That night, they barely shook hands on the stage there at Madison
palpable.
Square Garden, and you could feel the chill descend on the audience. And I knew then, as a Kennedy delegate, that was it. You're not going to bring us back together in time for the election. And that did not happen. And as a result, Ronald Reagan got elected, Jimmy Carter was out of office, and the Democratic Party stayed fractured for a long time.
So when I think about that here, in this metaphor, bring that full circle here to 2018, you know, you have to wonder, at what point does that impact lower races, like state Senate races, or like we have not really competitive at state attorney level, but in terms of turnout, getting voters out, Kweisi, people get dispirited when they think there's no unity or think there isn't a message.
Yeah, I think fortunately we've got a bottom-up effect, because there are so many contested local races that they're generating their own little spheres of influence and excitement. And in the aggregate, it probably helps push turnout up. Had that not been the case, I don't know that people would have been excited enough to get beyond where they are right now. And a lot of it still gets back to your point. Was early voting really just a sort of early vote of a vote that's not going to get very, very large in the end? And I don't know. One of the things about early voting is that it's too early to really kind of get a sense over the last four or five elections about what it means and how to read it.
We just started in 2010 with early voting.
Exactly. So I don't know.
410-467-WBAL. You can text us, 410-467-9225. I just want to get your take on this phenomenon, because you started in the city council, you then went to Congress. I started in the state central committee, went to the House of Delegates, then to the state Senate. A lot of people running for office who never held office before that
right.
are just jumping out and running for governor and Congress and everything else. I just want to get your take on that, because it almost is as people just wake up one day and decide, I want to run for something. Not there's anything wrong with that. That's the way in democracy. But it just seems like people just wake up one day wanting to jump in and run.
Well, you know, I came up at a time when there was a pecking order.
Yes.
And if you wanted to get involved because you really wanted to change things, you started in your community. You became the community association president, or you became, after 3 or 4 years of that kind of an internship, a candidate for a low office. So you went in that way. And once you got in that way, you proved yourself. And then you would run later for another office and you'd prove yourself. And that was the way it was done. So today it is kind of remarkable that people just jump right out and say, I'm running for
U.S.
president,
Senate,
running for
Congress,
Senate, running for Congress. Yeah. But I don't knock it. I mean, it's part of
sure.
the democratic process. Thank God we're in a country where you can do that. But it doesn't necessarily cause you to win. And the bottom line is winning. I mean, why get in a fight if you expect to lose?
And I think it does say something about your knowledge base when you get there, because I'm watching people who've never served office before, and not that you have to, who don't know how to craft legislation, who don't know what first reader, second reader, third reader. I mean, there's certain things you need to have a grasp on mm-hmm. when you get into public office. And I'm just being too old school. I just see an absence.
Well, the community level is the best place to start. You got to start in your neighborhood. You got to work with neighbors that you know and don't know, people you like and don't like, issues that mean a lot to people. And then people believe that your heart is in the right place, that you're a real good worker. I mean, that's how traditionally you
right.
came up in politics. So it is a little amazing to see how it is reversed.
Get my $50 and go down to the Board of Elections and file for office. It's about
right.
the way it is. Kweisi Mfume is here in studio. And Kweisi, coming up, we got to talk about the violence in this city. We are now sitting here on the 25th day, 24 homicides so far this month. We are still on a four-year trajectory of horrible violence in the city since the death of Freddie Gray. And we have people talking about it in this election. Kweisi, I went into the break talking with you about where we are in the city in crime. We've always had a crime problem. I remember when you were councilman, Kweisi Mfume, you were one of the leaders in trying to get the squeegee kids into a situation we could start getting these kids off the corner. God, that was only 10 years ago, right? Just
right.
a couple of years ago. But I mean, we've always had a crime problem. But post the death of Freddie Gray, we have experienced about a homicide a day in this city, and non-fatal shootings, exploding through the roof. Right now, all the elections, whether it's state's attorney, Baltimore City, Baltimore County Executive, the governor's race, are focusing on crime in Baltimore City. What are your thoughts as you see all this playing out, particularly in a time we can make decisions on policymakers?
Well, unfortunately, Baltimore remains a violent city in many respects. All the nice things that are happening are good, but there are too many people who are losing their lives, too many families that are being broken up. You know, I got tired of going to teenage funerals consoling teenage mothers because their child had been murdered. And it's not a knock on any particular segment, but it is an indictment of all of us if we don't find in ourselves the ability to do something about it. And you're right. That was 1980 we were having this discussion. You know, I was a young city councilman. The issue was crime and violence and unemployment and all the other things, and we're still here at the
you
same spot.
You remember us killing us? It was genocide. My Uncle Perrin's campaign back in 1985 when crack first came into the city. I was a young Democrat then before I became an independent. But anyway, but the difference now, Kweisi Mfume, is the fact that people are being caught up into this, whether they're killed or wounded or whatever, who aren't necessarily involved in crime. And that's the kind of difference. It's pervasive.
Right.
It's all over the place.
It's not just gang versus gang.
Exactly.
And there are a lot of innocent victims that don't get any attention after the fact. You know, it's a news item at the top of the hour, but after that, it's kind of lost. And yet these families are torn apart. These people, their lives will be changed forever. And then it affects people wanting to come into the city to live, of people who are here, who don't have the mobility, by the way, because of certain neighborhoods that they may live in, to be able to get out of those neighborhoods. So they're kind of trapped. Many of them are elderly, you know, and they don't have the kind of mobility that others have. So it's important, I think, just to be honest about the fact that this is a fight that has to be every day. It's a topic that has to be discussed every day. These are initiatives that have to be employed every day. We can't do it for 3 or 4 days a week and then run off and deal with something else.
One of the things, Kweisi, I like what the mayor did. I like what Mayor Catherine Pugh did at the end of last year coming into this year. Every day at 8 a.m., she has all of the different city agencies getting with all of the police, their non-police districts in the city, getting with each of these districts and examining what are the needs in your police district, housing, health, all the rest. And they had this daily edit. Then at 4 p.m., now this in person, at 4 p.m. on the phone, they then, what do we do? How do we correct this? And to me, that's a long-term approach to deal with this. But to me, that needs help. We need to have a state-city partnership in trying to address all those issues. Yeah,
and the mayor ought to be applauded for that, because I'm not going to say it's a new initiative. It may have happened somewhere else, but it's happening here now on a daily basis, twice a day. And I think once we get 4, 5, 6 months into it, there'll be some measurable sort of results. At least you'll be able to document where things are going and what's going up and what's going down.
And when it comes to the issue of crime, Kweisi, one of the things that we have to really take a hard look at, repeat violent offenders. We see people 25, 26 years old with 4 and 5 different arrests on violent things, and they're back on the street. Our criminal justice system, Kweisi, is not addressing the need of keeping some people, not everybody, we're talking about violent people, at least away from the rest of us.
Well, you know, I'm still hoping and praying that judges will have some say in all this beyond sitting on the bench. I mean, they've got to have an opinion, because the belief in the street is that this discretion that judges have is being used in the wrong way, because many times people see violent offenders being let go, put back on the street, only to be arrested, rearrested, and arrested again. And I know judges get very sensitive about this, but they've got to enter the dialogue and tell all of us,
what's going on?
Exactly. Why do you keep doing this? Particularly when there's reason not to do that. You know, somebody's been incarcerated, out again, back in again, and they are violent offenders, and now they have another charge, and you use your discretion to say, okay, I'll put you on home detention, I'll give you a slap on the wrist. Everybody doesn't need to be incarcerated, but some people don't need to be in the street as well.
And part of that, Kweisi Mfume, look, you don't have to be a fan of Governor Larry Hogan. He is a friend of mine, but so you don't have to be a fan of his. When the governor came into the city, had this big meeting where the mayor was there, the state's attorney, Marilyn Mosey, was there. We had the parole and probation was there. The judges didn't show up. And the reason the judges didn't show up for this big meeting, they said, was because they didn't want to politicize the bench. I understand that, but at some point, we got to talk about what is going on. Just don't make it about a Republican governor, because I remember when it was a Democratic governor, Glenn Denning, that the judges had no problem meeting with him. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what perception is. It's a partisan thing. We're trying to deal with real problems.
Yeah, the judges have to be a part of the dialogue. It's not that they have to explain their reaction, but
no,
they need to hear how frustrated many of us are at the fact that their discretion is often used to make our communities more dangerous.
Nobody, you in particular, myself, nobody believes more in a second chance than we do. But 4th, 5th, 6th, 7 chances? Come on, you're jeopardizing public safety with some of this. 410-467-WBAL. Let's get a caller in here. Let's get Don in Silver Spring. Don, you're on WBAL with Kweisi Mfume and me.
Hey, C4, how you doing?
Doing fine. Your thoughts, sir?
Mr. Mfume, you said that you were going to have also talk about national stuff. With
sure,
us,
we are. Mfume. You can bring it up. We're going to start the next half hour now. Sure.
Yeah, I want to pivot back to two things. One is, I kind of wonder whether the zero tolerance policy he might inadvertently or maybe intentionally be following Abraham Lincoln's advice about the best way to get rid of a bad law. Do you know what Lincoln said was?
What?
He said enforce it.
Okay. So in other words, you think it's a purposeful
zero
attempt
policy? What it's doing, it's highlighting what a lot of people think is a bad law, and it may end up it's going to get it changed, for one. I think it's kind of interesting that he may be following Lincoln.
Well, you're giving a whole lot more thought process than I am. I don't see a method to a lot of this madness. But what he is saying, though, Kweisi, is, and to me, we're going to talk more about this next half hour as well, is that we do, like we talk about, broken juvenile justice system. We have a broken immigration system. We have, on an average, 36,000, I just saw the numbers, illegal immigrants every day awaiting adjudication. Not enough judges, not enough prosecutors, and yet we're flooding the system with more people through this process. It's broken. It's just broken. Once again, pleased to have in the studio Kweisi Mfume, former Maryland congressman, former national NAACP director, and CEO, president, CEO, as well as now involved in many other things in our area, including the Morgan State University Board of Regents. And also, while I'm on it, Kweisi, what else are you involved with right now? What are some of the things you're doing
enough.
Right now? I know. It is.
At my age, that's enough.
Oh, man, don't start. When people look at you, they say, he still looks like old Congressman Mfume.
Right. I just don't move as
that
fast.
That water fountain. Then what are you drinking, man? No, but, okay, so Morgan is pretty much what you're dealing with in terms of the Board of Regents.
That's my heart, soul, and love. I've been on that board a number of years. I've been chairing the board over there for the last 6 years. The fate of the university, the growth of the university, and its larger effect here in the state of Maryland is where I've been, and that's where I've dedicated a great deal of time.
Let's talk, if we can, because you watch news like we all do about the rise in the issue of juvenile crime in our city, even though we've always had young people that have committed, you know, certain crimes, mischievous types of crimes. Mm-hmm. It's the rise in violent crime. When you look at last year, for instance, Kweisi, we saw a 33% increase in carjackings, and the majority of that, the overwhelming majority of that, according to former Baltimore City Police Commissioner Kevin Davis, Commissioner Darrell D'Souza, he's now gone, and even Commissioner Tuggle, the acting commissioner, they will tell you the overwhelming majority are juveniles who are engaged in this carjacking part and then the other types of violent crimes. We have a juvenile justice system that even the Secretary of Department of Juvenile Justice admits in many ways is broken. When are we going to talk about a Marshall Plan? We're going to have a Marshall Plan where we can stop all the politics, forget who's over there, and figure how we can save some of our juveniles and deal with our juveniles.
And let me make it a personal for just a moment. You know, I grew up raised by a single mom who died in my arms when I was 16 years of age, living in West Baltimore. Didn't find out who my father was until the night of my mother's death. Dropped out of school, high school, 2 weeks later. Took odd jobs to try to raise my sisters, got frustrated like a lot of young black men because I would turn on the TV and I would see Ozzie and Harriet. I'd turn off the TV and look at my surroundings and all I saw was abject poverty. And so that built up this sort of anger, whether it's justifiable or not. That's what happened to me. And I struck out by hanging out with gangs, running through the streets. You know, I became a teenage parent. Everything you could do to be on your way to hell in the handbasket, I was doing. And fortunately for me, I got out of that. By the age of 22, I started to realize, based on a number of different things, what I could be, not what I was. So I understand, to some extent, the frustration that I see in some of these juveniles. What I don't understand is the level of violence perpetrated against the community, against innocent people, and the inability to see what you can be at some point in time. Most of these kids will tell you that they don't expect to live to be 25.
That's what they say.
Some of them are still laying away clothes. I didn't know that still happened. When I say lay away, you put a few dollars down this week, a few dollars down that week, because they know what they want to be buried in. And it is the sort of horror story that is with us every day. It just breaks your heart. So when we talk about this issue, we got to talk about it all the time. So much of this deals with the family. That's the real core of our society. If the family is not operating, it's kind of hard to expect kids to come out of that family operating the way they should. And, you know, to whatever extent it was for Bill Cosby, as he said famously or infamously 10, 15 years ago, that we know our problem sometimes starts with our families. He got ostracized for it, and then
terrible.
The rest is history.
Even President Obama, he spoke at the national NAACP and talked about the breakup of the family and got booed as he was talking about
It's the worst thing that could have happened to the community, the breakup of the family, not having a meal at a table with a kid, even if you're in poverty, to sit down and talk about homework, to lead by example. Those things made a difference in my life, and I know that those things still make a difference, but there's so many kids that don't get that. So what we see is we turn on the 11 o'clock news, and we see these violent, violent acts by young people who don't have a sense of values the way they used to have, and in many respects are lost. And, you know, it's complicated by the juvenile justice system. This is my opinion now. That doesn't do its job. you know, it's complicated to some extent by judges who take discretion too far and just keep turning people out, like the young lady who said, my son needs help. Please don't send him
Talk
back
into... Talk
about
the death of Officer A.B. Caprio and the 16-year-old whose mother was in court begging the court to hold her son. That's right. Why people know what you're talking
about.
And
can you believe that? And they sent the kid out, and then he goes out, unfortunately, and gets involved in a murder. That's horrific.
Terrible. But Kweisi, what you just laid out, and to me, it's incumbent on, yes, the institution, judicial branch, in terms of what the judges are doing, the executive branch, in terms of juvenile justice. But you were a legislator. I was a legislator. I do not see the sense of urgency in elected officials. I mentioned it after the death of Officer Caprio, that there should have been some emergency type of gathering of elected officials, something to determine what is going on here. How many, besides the 16-year-old, Kweisi, there was another 16-year-old who was in with the other three in the House, robbing the House in the situation that led to the death of Officer Caprio, who was also on home monitoring. How many young people are on his home monitoring program, which, by the way, I'm sure you weren't aware. I wasn't aware. The home monitoring anklets that they have don't have GPS in them. So when the young person isn't where they're supposed to be, they can't find them.
Right.
I mean, in today's world, even the Baltimore Sun wrote, that's ubiquitous. GPS should be in all this. I guess what I'm saying is public policymakers should be making this a crisis, an emergency, to deal with this, because we're losing kids every day.
Right. And these kids are poor black, poor white, poor Latino. You know, they're part of the community that we call home. And if you don't have that larger discussion, the question becomes, who is going to have it? You can't wait until the crime is committed to then figure out, okay, should we talk? And then you still don't talk. I just don't see enough initiatives. I don't like pointing fingers, but
I'm
telling you,
fingers
it's breaking my heart. You know, I've been around forever, and I don't see the kind of change that meant so much to me when I thought that I was getting involved and getting into politics because you could really make a difference. You can make a difference, but Clarence, I got to tell you, so many people now seem to want to be elected to have the
don't want to do the work.
They like the H-O-N in front of their name, the honorable this, the honorable that, the honorable this. And then to have people running behind them, you know how staff gets, they just tell you what you want to hear. I mean, that's really not why you should be in politics. It's
and
not.
If in an election year, the reason I'm so hard on this, we were going to do a four-hour special dedicated to this, and tragically the death of County Executive Kevin Kamenetz was the same day we were going to do this four-hour special, and we, of course, appropriately canceled the special to talk about County Executive Kamenetz. But in an election year, all of these elected officials need to be asked the question, what are you doing to ensure that juveniles are being appropriately dealt with now? Because after this election year, I'm sorry, Kweisi, they're not going to get back to this. I don't think they're going to come back to this issue at all until maybe next election time. Just tragic. 410-467-WBAL. You can text me, 410-467-9225. I want to add, as we go to break, Kweisi, one of the things you also had different in your time than mine, there was a certain consciousness in the community that other people weren't going to let you fail. They were going to make sure to be there for you. A lot of that's missing today. We don't have those support systems in the community to catch that young person when they're in that situation.
Yeah, it's much different. And, you know, let me get back to your point about elected officials. I guess I can say this, being a recovering politician, and who I'm not looking for a vote for anybody.
Me neither. That's why I can say what I say. Me neither.
It just galls me, the fact that people seem to want to get into politics, not everybody, but a lot, for the wrong reason. You know, to be popular or to have somebody call your name.
Get
or to
tickets
have
to the
a
Ravens
title.
Game.
Yeah, to get the freebies and all that. Your late uncle, the first African-American congressman from Maryland, Perrin J. Mitchell, used to say, this seat, and he would point to his seat on the floor of the House, does not belong to me. It belongs to the people of my congressional district. And if I ever do anything that takes my attention off of them and does not advocate for their issues but rather puts the attention on me, I don't deserve it, and I hope you would vote me out of office.
Kweisi Mfume is here in studio, and I really think it's important to hear from somebody who has served as many different levels, from local to national to really international when he was head of the NAACP, to weigh in on Baltimore issues. He's a Baltimorean, ladies and gentlemen, somebody who cares and loves this city as much as I do. And we've got to, Kweisi, I'm going to go to calls in a minute. We've got to develop in these elected officials and other people around us a sense of urgency. And I can't use it enough. That's missing right now. We're losing people every day.
We are. And the question becomes, and see, again, I don't want to be too judgmental here, but at the end of the day, the question becomes, what are you going to do?
Right.
When are you going to do it? And how will I know you've done it?
Election day is tomorrow. And, I mean, we have an opportunity now, while the focus is on people who are seeking votes, to give some solutions, to give some vision, to give something. Where do you see us in 2019? Where are we going to be on this issue of kids, juveniles, in 2019?
And we've got a lot of good elected officials that work on that day in and day out, but they are the minority.
Absolutely.
I'm telling you, they're the minority. The others, and, you know, I'll let you say that.
You know, I'm going to get him to the point. He's going to start naming names in a minute. But then let's get Ian. Let's get Ian and Butler. Ian, good morning. You're on WBL with Kweisi Mfume and me. Go ahead, Ian.
Hey, C4. How you doing?
Doing great. Kweisi,
I tell you, you know, I've watched you for years. You and I are probably close to the same age. And one thing I could always say about you, even though I was on the opposite side politically from your viewpoint, I could always listen to you because you always came off as a gentleman and you always came off as somebody that even though, you know, you didn't disagree with everything, the person on the other side, I felt like you were somebody that listened. And that's really missing in the world today.
Ian, thank you so much, because Kweisi, we started the show off talking about the lack of civility in our language. That's one of the things I think Ian is speaking to, is that even if you disagree with Kweisi Mfume politically, you are never going to demean people. You're not going to, you know, do what we're doing in our politics today.
Who was it? I think the French philosopher Voltaire, who once said that I don't and may not ever agree with whatever you say, but I will fight to my death to defend your right to say it. We had a sense of civility where people appreciated the fact that everybody didn't think like them or act like them. And that was the only way we could find consensus if we knew that going in. Sometimes now we think we're in a monolithic society because we think everybody does think like us or should think like us. And you never get to a consensus.
And social media actually reinforces that, because then you can find the people that agree with you and lock everybody else out.
Yeah.
In many ways, social media, Kweisi, I don't want to sound like an old fogey, but has really done a lot to keep people in their individual silos and not open their minds to think about other sides of an argument. Because you can find the people who agree with you that, you know, C4 is a horrible individual. And you don't, I mean, you know, it's different than before you had to actually talk to people and deal with them face to face.
The silos exist, and they've been made stronger, I think. By the fact that you can kind of isolate your discussion with people who feel exactly like you. But if that's the case, you will never, ever, in my opinion, get to a common ground, because you'll be so diametrically opposed that you would think it's my way or the highway and I can't deal with you if you're not with me.
Hence Donald Trump. Let's get Earl in Baltimore in here. Earl, you're on WBAL with Kweisi Mfume and me. Go ahead, Earl.
Yes, I'm Earl King. Mr. Kwame for some time, you know, from Turner Station. I'm very proud of...
Don't listen to your radio, Earl. Don't listen to your radio.
All right. I'm very proud of Mr. Fumi, because he helped me turn my life around, and a lot of guys in Turner Station, you know, to change their life around and stop their foolishness and so forth. And so Kweisi is very important to me. I've been knowing him for years, Earl King, and he's very important to me. And he really opened my eyes to see that I should turn my life around.
Yeah? Earl, thank you very much. You know, Kweisi, that should feel good. And what we're missing, I think, in many ways, my Uncle Perrin used to do it, my dad used to do it, Senator Clarence Blount used to do it. We used to have individuals who took the time to involve themselves in many of their constituents' lives. And lots of times, Kweisi, I can be honest, I hear from people, they don't see these elected officials till election time. They don't see them at grocery stores. They don't see them shopping in the same place they shop. They just don't see them.
Yeah, and you know, we need more people who get to that point in your life when you've got some extra time and you can give some of it back, to give it back. You know, I worked for years with Big Brothers and Big Sisters of Central Maryland, Parents Anonymous, Boy Scouts of America, just because, you know, that and coaching sports, I wanted to find a way. I felt guilty because so many people had impacted my life who didn't have to and turned me around, that you automatically want to give something back. And politics is one way to give it back, so I would strongly urge people who are thinking about politics to remember the old Perrin Mitchell lesson, that if you're going in it for the wrong reason, don't go in it at all.
Final minute I have with you, Kweisi Mfume. I still, with all what's going on, I feel positive about Baltimore, but it's so hard at times. Just how do you see us moving forward? I mean, as a city, trying to put our arms around all the problems that we have.
Well, I just know that it's going to take everybody's effort, everybody's opinion, and at the end of the day, everybody's blood, sweat, and tears. None of us are going to have the singular answer. All of us in the aggregate can come up with solutions to problems, but we've got to get beyond the walls, too. You know, I mean, sexism, racism, anti-Semitism are wrong. Black bigotry, just as cruel and evil as white bigotry or any other kind. Gay bashing, union bashing, police bashing, they don't get us very far. Those are the things that keep us on different sides of the argument and keep us at bay with one another. We've just got to find a way to agree that we're all going to live here together and make it better, or we will all in our own time die here, and it will continue to get worse.
Kweisi Mfume, ladies and gentlemen, and I am going to try my best to get in the schedule when it will allow as we move forward. Kweisi, thank you so much for the time, sir.
Thank you, Clarence. My appreciation to all you do.
Thank you. Everybody stay here.